Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're so grateful to come into your house tonight. We thank you, God, that tonight is your night, Lord. We came to hear from you, not from a man or a woman, not from the young or the old, not from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. God, we came to hear from you. So be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. Lord, we'll praise you and thank you for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Bless our brothers and sisters, Lord, the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals, God. Thank you, Lord, for Calvary Chapel and Harvest, for Oak Valley, for Ecclesia and The Way and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God. All the great churches that are out there, Lord, for Victory and the Assemblies and Four Square denominations, for our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters. Lord, at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit, and touch us, heal us, encourage us, God. Be amongst us as you would be amongst them as well, Lord. And we thank you for it, Father. Also, Lord, we do not just forget about our brothers and sisters that are captive or that are being persecuted, God. We ask that you deliver them, protect them, Lord, wherever that all over the earth, God, that you would just deliver them, Lord, and strengthen them. May they endure to the end, God, to your glory and to your praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say,
amen.
Amen. Tonight, get your Bibles out, and I want to talk to you about a subject called A Guide to Handling Loss. Turn with me to the book of Job. You should have known I was going there, right? Book of Job. And tonight, I believe that God contains in the Scripture everything we need for our life. In fact, if you look throughout the Bible, you'll find many guides to how to handle life's situation. If you read in the New Testament, you'll find out the apostle writes and he says that these stories in the Scriptures are not just history lessons. They're actually examples for us of how to manage turbulent times, of how to manage life, of things that can be warning signs along the road or maybe pitfalls that we can avoid. As well, how to handle success and what to do when you have good things coming to your life. And tonight is no different. Talking about a guide to handling loss, yes, Job will be our guide, but ultimately the Holy Spirit is our guide. And I believe that tonight as we take a look at just a little piece, because, I mean, you got 40 plus chapters in the book of Job, right? 42 chapters, something like that. And it would be very difficult for us to cover all that ground. So I'm just going to cover a couple of scriptures out of the book of Job, things that I see that Job did, that he exemplified in his life about how he handled loss, that the Holy Spirit will bring to us and bring out some truths as we go through about how we can handle loss. Some of you guys may not be familiar with the story of Job, so let me just give you just some of the story. Let me set the scene for you. The Bible tells us that Job was a righteous man, one who feared God and who shunned evil. He had sons and daughters. They all got together on different nights of the week, and they came together and they ate together, and Job would pray for his children just in case any of them messed up. He would always be offering sacrifices to the Lord, and this was a godly man. Now, not only was he a godly man, he was a wealthy man. In fact, some scholars look at Job and they believe that he was a king or that he was a very wealthy, rich ruler of the land that he was in. Whatever the case, we do know that Job had flocks, that Job had herds, that Job had land, that Job was very wealthy, very influential. He had servants in his house that took care of things. And this was a very blessed man. Now, we get sort of like the curtain is pulled back and we get a behind the scenes look at what's taking place in heaven. And the Bible tells us that there was a day where the sons of God, the angels, came to present themselves before Almighty God. And in their midst, here comes Satan, and God comes up to Satan, almost like God's a general walking through the ranks, and he sees Satan, someone who's not supposed to be there, and he says, "Where are you? What are you doing here? And where did you come from?" And Satan responds, "Well, I've been walking to and fro throughout the earth." Now, something is obviously afoot because the Lord says immediately in response to this reply, "Well, have you considered my servant Job?" In other words, you've been walking to and fro throughout the earth, and I know what you're doing. You're a roaring lion seeking whom you may devour. And he says, in all of your roaring and in all of your praying and in all of your following throughout the earth, did you get a look at my servant Job? In other words, you were taking a look all over the place, probably found some people who didn't fear God and who didn't shun evil, and they were easy prey. But did you look at Job? Now, this should send shivers down your spine because, you know, when I think about God saying, "Have you considered my servant Daniel?" I might say, "God, you could have just stayed silent," right? But God thought enough of Job to say, have you considered him? That he fears God and then he shuns evil. And Satan says, well, does he do this for no reason? I mean, you've put a hedge of protection around him. You've blessed everything that he puts his hand to. Of course he loves you, right? But take away everything that he has and he'll curse you. And God says, listen, you go ahead, but you don't put a finger on the man. Don't touch him. So Satan goes out from the presence of the Lord and he wipes out everything that Job has. In fact, if you read the book, it's quite scary when you read about it, because here comes a servant. He tells Job, hey, your flocks are out in the field feeding, and a band of raiders came in and they just wiped them out while he's still talking. Another guy comes in and he says, the fire of heaven fell on all your crops and devoured it all. While he's still talking, another guy comes up and says, your kids were eating in the house and the great wind blew through and fell upon them all. I mean, just one right after the other, right after the other, right after the other. Bad news upon bad news upon bad news upon bad news. And in one day, everything that Job had acquired, all that was important to him, all that mattered to him, was taken away from him. In fact, it would be like us, you know, here we are at home and all of a sudden we receive a phone call from our employer or our boss and they say, hey, you know what? The company folded. I don't know what happened, but we are shutting our doors. Don't show up to work tomorrow morning. You don't have a job anymore. There's no pension. There's no package. There's no retirement. Your 401k is gone. All of your stock options have gone. And then you get a call from your financial planner. Hey, you know how we were making those deals on the side? Man, there was a war in South America and we had everything invested in kiwi fruits down there and they just wiped them all out. There was a fire that spread throughout all the kiwi trees and they are completely gone. And then you get a text message that said, saying, you know, this is the police and we got a hold of your number. We couldn't get a hold of your phone because it was busy, but we wanted to make sure you knew to call us. And you called them back and the officer on the other end of the line said, all of your children were driving and they were headed over to one of their house and every last one of them died in a terrible car accident. That would be what it would be like. Just layer upon layer upon layer upon layer of bad news. And here Job reacts to the news. Job chapter number 1, I want you to take a look at one verse. Job chapter 1, verse number 20. Job chapter number 1, verse number 20. Look at Job's response. And Job arose, tore his robe. See, his robe represented who he was. If you looked at the robe of a wealthy man, you could identify him from far away. That's Job over there. See those nice clothes over there? See the gold? See the, you know, see the fine linen? See whatever it is that he's wearing? You could tell he was a very rich and wealthy person. It was as if he was tearing himself apart. Symbol and expression of who he was. I would have torn my robe too. Look at what it says. Tore his robe. Shaved his head. This was a symbol of deep mourning. This showed that this is not okay. I'm not okay with this. And he shaves all of his hair off. I would have shaved my head too. Look what it says. And he fell to the ground. My goodness, I would have probably fell to the ground first, right? I would have just been a wreck, a crying, bawling, squalling mess. And I would have just laid there on the ground and cried myself to sleep in the fetal position. And yet, look at what Job does when he falls to the ground. So here he is. He arose, tore his robe, shaved his head, and he fell to the ground and worshiped. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I am challenged every time I read that verse. Over 20 years, I've studied the Bible as a Christian. Just going through the Bible year after year. Every time I hit Job chapter 1, verse number 20, it hits me like a ton of bricks. Because I know in my heart of hearts, there has been a lot less loss in my life, and I have not been driven to my knees to worship God. I've been driven to my knees to cry out, to pray, to tell God he's unjust, or to tell God it's not fair, or to cry, or I've been driven to the phone to call someone else and ask them what they think about that, or, you know, all sorts of other responses, right? We have much less loss than Job has in his life, and yet we seem to crumble, don't we? I mean, maybe it's just me in this place. Maybe you guys are all okay. Maybe you guys should be up here preaching this message today. Pastor Dan, this is what you do when this happens. But I know me, and I know there have been a lot. How about this one? You didn't even have it, but the potential of it was lost, and you're there crying to God about it. I didn't even have it, but Lord, I wanted it, and I lost it, and God, you can't get over that. I mean, that's like crazy, and yet it happens to us all the time. And so God says that this is an example for us. This is a roadmap. This is a guide. This is somebody who has weathered the storm and who has been through this. And listen to this. Job didn't have the power of the Holy Spirit. Did you catch that? Who has the power of the Holy Spirit? We do today. In other words, we are better equipped today with the power of the Holy Spirit, Christ in us, God on the inside of us, to handle life situations than Job was. Hello? So that means that we should be able to take a look at this roadmap, and now the Holy Spirit is our teacher. He is our guide. He said he will remind us of everything that he has spoken, right? He will remind us of the word. He will remind us of what Jesus said. And therefore, because we have those things in our heart and because we're attentive and listening to the Holy Spirit now, when we encounter loss, then we can make it. Anybody want to make it? I know I want to make it. Oh, my goodness. Come on. Come on. Couple of things, a guide to handling loss. First one is this, is worship God in loss. Worship God in loss. Now, like Cameron was saying tonight in the exhortation, worship is not just a slow song. Worship is our life laid down before God. And I believe that that's what Job did when he fell to the ground before God. After he tore his robe and he shaved his head, he fell to the ground and he just presented himself before God. Why? Because God is just. You know, in the next verses, if you want to keep reading, Job says, "The naked I came into this world and naked I'm going out of this world," right? I'm not taking nothing with me. And he says, "The Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." In other words, he starts to bless the Lord. He starts to speak about God's goodness. You know, if all you had was a slow worship song that you learned here in church that we sang way too many times, that you wonder why they're singing that song again. Here's why. Because in the middle of a tragedy, in the middle of loss, if all you had was "Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul," because your soul isn't going to want to worship the Lord. Your soul isn't going to want to bless the Lord. So your spirit man has to start speaking to your soul, start talking to yourself, right? You say, but if you talk to yourself, you're crazy. Yes, you're getting out of the flesh, out of the natural, out of your natural mind, and you're getting into the spiritual. And you got to stir yourself up, see, and start to worship the Lord. It's more than a song, but if all you had was a song, that's all you'd need. Maybe it's that fast one we sang tonight. "In the midst of the darkest night, let your love be my shining light. Breaking chains that were holding me." See, if that's all you had was a song that we sang way too much in church, then praise God, you have something that can help you. It's a tool. Worship God. Start to declare. You know, a good worship song will declare who God is. And that's why a good worship song should also be catchy so that you can learn it. And, you know, oftentimes we learn by singing things, right? So when we were little, we learned the ABCs. How? A, B, C, D, E. We were singing them, right? We learned them. In the same way, if you have a good theologically sound worship song or praise song, then it will teach you about the attributes of God. And so when you start to worship God and you start to praise God and when you start to dwell on the goodness of God, you will no longer be dwelling on your loss, but now you'll be getting yourself into God. Amen. So the first place we find on our roadmap to handling loss is that we need to worship God. Second thing is this, Job chapter 2. Job chapter 2, the story goes on. Satan says to God, he presents himself once again. God says, "See, I told you so." And Satan says, "Oh yeah, whatever. See, you know, bone for bone and skin for skin." In other words, you still are protecting him. But if you touch his body, if he's in pain, he'll curse you to your face. God says, just don't kill him. So Satan goes out and he put painful boils all over Job from the head to the toe. We find Job sitting in an ash heap, scraping the boils with a potsherd. That's quite a picture, isn't it? I mean, my goodness, why are you doing that, Job? What's going on here? His friends come up, they don't even recognize him later on. And they sit down and weep and can't even talk. But take a look at what happens in Job chapter 2, verse number 9 and verse number 10. Job's wife comes out. Now, before we get down on Job's wife, because oftentimes we read these verses and we think, who is this crazy woman, right? You almost picture her hair's a mess and she's just kind of got that weird, wild look in her eye and she might be twitching a little bit and she's kind of like, curse God and die, you know? But before we start getting down on Job's wife, just remember a couple things. Remember, number one, that Job's wife lost her entire family the same day Job did. Hello, she carried those babies. Those were her babies. And remember, number two, that she lost all the wealth that she shared with her husband. And number three, remember that she's married to Job, who now is physically ill and can't do anything about it. Okay? So before we get judging Job's wife, because I know I have read that and I have judged that woman and said, oh my goodness, that woman needs to take a chill pill. She needs to go get saved. She needs to do something. I don't know what, but get out of Job's face. He's suffered enough. But remember that she suffered too. She lost all her wealth. She lost her family. And now she feels like she's losing her husband. And she's angry and she doesn't know how to handle it. And so she comes out, Job chapter 2, verse number 9. Then his wife said to him, do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die. Verse number 10. But he said to her, you speak as one of the foolish women speaks. Shall we indeed accept good from God, and shall we not accept adversity? And then the narrative goes on and says, in all this, Job did not sin with his lips. See, when you read the book of Job, and when you read through and you hear what his friends are saying to him, a lot of it sounds good. A lot of it sounds right. It's based on experience, based on religion, based on tradition. There's actually five discourses that Job has to go through. And so here he comes through all these things, and at the very end of the book, you'll find out that Job, throughout the entire book, did not sin with what he said. In fact, God speaks to Job's friends, and he says, Job didn't sin by speaking anything wrong about me. So when you read the book of Job and you read about what Job says about God, you can trust that that's true. See, sometimes we shy away from books like this. It's too long. I don't understand it. I don't know what's being said. Well, listen, if you know that you can trust what Job is saying, and if you can see the outcomes of what Job went through and get on the other side and find out that God is saying, hey, listen, there's something bigger going on here than you, Job, then we can learn from Job's example. What do we learn from Job's example? Remember, we don't have time to go through the whole book. We've got two verses so far, right? First one, he worships God, and then he says, naked I came into this world, naked I will leave. God gives, and the Lord is taken away now. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now, verse number 10, he says, you speak as one of the foolish women speaks. And he says, shall we indeed accept good from God, and shall we not accept adversity? In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. So in other words, we find in two verses, Job is consistent with what he speaks about God. That's called integrity. So, a guide to handling loss. Number one is worship God in loss. Number two is hold fast to your integrity. The very question that his wife came and asked him, do you still hold on to your integrity? The answer is absolutely yes, I do. In other words, that same song that I was singing yesterday, I'm still going to be singing today. And the same song I'm singing today is the same song I'm going to be singing tomorrow. The same confession that I said that God is good before the tragedy is the same confession I'm going to have in the middle of the tragedy, and the same confession I'm going to have on the other side of the tragedy. Recently was very moved and impacted. There's a guy at a church. Some of you guys are familiar with some of the music from Jesus Culture and Bethel and Reading. And the guy's name is Chris Kilala. Quite a name, isn't it? And he shares a story on their album about a time that him and his wife went through where they lost a child. No one should go through that loss. My sister-in-law went through that, and it was terrible. It was tough. It was gut-wrenching. And still to this day, it's very painful. And so here he's sharing, and he's talking about how before they were believing God, they were praying, they were speaking the word, you know, they were believing that God was a miracle working God, and then they lost their son. And he said that he felt it was important that after the loss of their son, that they start to write songs that continue to declare God to be a miracle working God. In other words, just because my experience doesn't seem to line up with what I know about God doesn't mean that God has changed. It means that something here happened that I don't understand, but I'm going to continue to declare who God is, what God is doing, how God operates. I'm going to continue to declare the truth that I know about God in order to stir myself up and keep myself consistent. I'm going to remain integrous through this whole thing. In fact, if you know the word integrity, you know that it can often speak of a vessel or of a ship that maintains its integrity. It maintains its shape under pressure or under battering or under some sort of a barrage, things that come against it. And for all of us in life, if we are going to maintain our integrity, that means come hell or high water, doesn't matter what comes against me, doesn't matter the attack that comes against me, I'm going to maintain my shape. My shape is the posture of prayer. My shape is a confession of who God is. My shape is that I'm going to unrelentingly hold on to God and His promises. That means that I'm going to continue to give. That means I'm going to continue to grow. That means I'm going to continue to hold on to God no matter what happens in life. I will hold on to my integrity through it all. Be careful about what you say. Be careful because your words will shape your life. In fact, in the book of James chapter 3, you'll find out that that tongue is a little rudder that turns the ship. Very important. Notice that the Bible points out specifically, Job did not sin with his words. Because of Job speaking about who God is, speaking the truth of God's word, it translated into Job living his life. Maybe I can get a mic here, and this thing's popping like crazy. Are you guys hearing that? Okay, we'll keep going then. We'll keep going. You guys okay with a little pop every now and then? Just in case, I'm going to give myself a little room here. All right, so if you see a wire hanging, that's what that is. But we need to be careful not to sin with our words. We need to continue to declare the goodness of God over our lives. If you're handling loss, if you're dealing with loss, doesn't matter if it's a loss of a child, doesn't matter if it's a loss of finances, doesn't matter if it's a loss of health or maybe something that you thought you were going to have that you didn't have. You know, we kind of laughed about that, but that's very real. And I know people all the time that have dealt with things that their expectations were up high. They had great hope and great faith and believing God, and then they dealt with the loss of their expectations. That somehow God didn't meet up with what they were believing Him for, and now they have a great disappointment and a void where they felt God let them down. And they're coping with that loss. Very important what we speak. Now, I'm not saying that you can't speak what you feel or speak what happened. See what I'm saying? Sometimes we get so centered on I just have to say everything right, and therefore you ask them, hey, how you doing? I'm fine, bless God. Are you feeling sick, man? You look terrible. No, I'm healed in the name of Jesus by His stripes. And when we start making these faith confessions, we drive everyone around us kind of crazy, you know? And people wonder, are you for real right now? You know, like, is this really who you are? Just tell me the truth. You can share this with me. Oh, no, I'm not going to say nothing, right? So when I say that, I don't want you to take it to the nth degree. In other words, don't get in this ditch or that ditch where you don't say anything or where you're cursing God and you die, okay? Stay right in the middle of maturity, right? And that's where you say, you know what? My expectations weren't met, but God's good. God's still faithful. God's got something better for me. Remember, Job didn't shy away from the Lord taking away. He said the Lord gave, but now the Lord's taken away, but blessed be the name of the Lord, right? You can find all throughout the Psalms people that dealt with loss, people that dealt with tragedy, people that were lamenting and mourning, and most of the time they get real, and not only real, they get real, real. You know what I'm saying? And see, when you say it a second time, it makes it even more severe, right? They get real, real, right? And they just bear everything. There's people that say, I was looking at somebody else prospering, they were wicked, they were evil, and I was wondering why they had stuff and I didn't. You can find that in your Bible. But you know what happens? They say, then I went to God's house. I got in the presence of God and I saw their end. Those guys are not headed for heaven with God. They're headed for destruction. They're headed for hell. And I recognized and I realized, even though they got good things on the earth, I'm going to get good things in eternity. And what's more important? See, they get real, they get open, they get raw with it, but they continue to keep their eyes focused on the goodness of God, on the integrity of who God is. Right? Because God is the most integrous. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So we have to consistently declare who He is. And it's okay to say, you know what? I'm not feeling too good in my body, but I'm believing God for my healing. Or, you know what? I just lost a bunch of money, but God is my provider, right? Continue to declare who God is. Be careful with your words not to speak evil of God. but to declare what it is truthfully and to, with that truth, declare the goodness of God or what you're believing God for. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 6 in the New International Version says this. It says, righteousness guards the person of integrity, but wickedness overthrows the sinner. See, if we start to sin with our lips, we're headed for something bad, right? But if we can allow the righteousness of God to guard our hearts, then out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks, right? So we need to guard our hearts, continue to believe God for great and mighty things, even in the midst of tragedy, even in the midst of loss, even in the midst of expectations that didn't get met. Next thing that we find, Job chapter 2, verse 10. Let's read it again. A guide to handling loss. First thing we saw was worship God in loss. Second thing we saw was hold fast to your integrity. Third thing is this, Job chapter 2, verse number 10. Job is speaking to his wife. Look at the reply that Job has for his wife. He says, you speak as one of the foolish women speaks. Shall we indeed accept good from God, and shall we not accept adversity? And all this, Job did not sin with his lips. Here's what I see Job doing, okay? Remember, once again, let's not get down on Job's wife, okay? Because Job didn't even get down on his wife. Look at what he says. He said, you speak as one of the foolish women speaks. Notice he didn't call her, you foolish woman. Right? He said, what's coming out of you right now is not you. You speak as one of the foolish women speaks. In other words, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. What is he doing? He is speaking life into her heart. So the principle for us tonight in a guide to handling loss is this: speak life to others. In other words, your loss is not only your loss. Your loss is your spouse's loss. Sometimes your loss is your friend's loss. Sometimes your loss is your coworker's or your neighbor's loss. And there's going to be people in your life that surround you that when loss comes to your life, you're going to have to lift them up. You're going to have to be strong in the midst of a tragedy for someone else. I can't tell you how many people I've talked to that as they have gone through, especially specifically health trials. Pastor Joe was talking about this a couple weeks ago on a Sunday night when he ministered, about how in the midst of a tragedy, people would come in to the room where they were experiencing this trial. His son was there on the operating table, hearts cracked open, right? Chest is cracked open, hearts exposed, all that kind of stuff. And people are just falling apart, and he's having to minister to them right there in the room. Yet, this is his son on the table. Had another lady who had cancer, and she was going through the cancer treatments and lost all of her hair, and you know she had to go through all sorts of surgeries, all that kind of stuff. And we were talking one day, and we said, "How you doing? How you holding up?" You know, she came out of the hospital and finally went to her home, and she said, "I finally had to tell my husband, no more visitors. We're done. Because every time somebody comes in, they start crying all over me. Then I got to encourage them. It's going to be fine. I'm going to be okay. God is good. He's the healer. Hey, listen, let's pray together. Let me pray for you right now." And she's going, "This is crazy. I need to heal, you know, like, come on, be strong for me." And yet, that's exactly what Job had to do. Here he is, lost everything. Here he is, doesn't know what's going on. Here he is. She didn't have the boils all over her body. He was head to toe boil scraping it with a pot, right? And he has to tell his wife, "You speak as one of the foolish women speaks." And he had to start speaking life into her heart. He had to start lifting her up. Listen, we're going to hold fast to our integrity. We're going to bless God. Should we accept just the good from God and not adversity? Listen, whatever God gives, God is good no matter what. And therefore, I know that if God's got me going through a rough road, there's got to be something good on the other side. So know that when you go through a trial, man, if you can keep yourself strong, if you can keep yourself integrous, you can speak life, then you're going to start to lift others up and start to speak life into them. Hey, this isn't so bad. Listen, this loss for the company is not going to be a bad loss. This is going to cause us to work smarter. It's going to cause us to change. It's going to cause us to grow. Hey, you know what? This thing happened in the neighborhood. We're going to gather together. We're going to pray. We're going to believe God. We're going to call heaven down on this place. And we're going to see the goodness of God in our community. Talk to your family. Hey, you know what? This loss, this trial that we're going through as a family, God is up to something good on the back end. I don't know what he's going to do. He's going to do something though. And let's pray. Let's believe God. And let's see what God does in our lives. Start to speak life. Start to speak encouragement. Start to believe God for great and mighty things. Last thing that we see is this, and I'm not going to go to the book of Job. If you want to start turning in your Bibles to the book of James. One little word, James chapter 5, as you turn there, here's the word, perseverance. Most important thing on our guide to handling loss is perseverance. Book of James chapter 5, right after the book of Hebrews, you'll find the book of James. Chapter number 5 and verse number 11. Let's look at what it says together. James chapter 5, verse 11 says, indeed, we count them blessed who endure. Everybody say endure.
Endure.
Then he goes on, he says, you have heard of the perseverance. Everybody say perseverance.
Perseverance.
Of Job. And seen the end intended by the Lord, that the Lord is very compassionate and merciful. In other words, when you see the end of Job's life, if you read through the back of the book, if you fast forward through all the different discourses and all the talk that goes on in the book of Job, and you go in the last couple chapters, you'll find out that God doubled everything Job owned. God doubled his children. God doubled his wealth. That God doubled his flocks. That God blessed his years on the earth. He was able to see not only his grandchildren, but his great-grandchildren. Lived 140 years on the earth. Psalm chapter number 90 says we get 70 years, 80 if we have the strength. See, Job got a double life. 70 plus 70 is 140. God gave Job double for his trouble in the end. And the Bible tells us in the book of James that that was the end intended by the Lord. In other words, God wasn't going to put Job through this trial, through this stuff with the devil, just to have some sort of cosmic battle that Job didn't get nothing. God was looking to bless Job even more, and God knew that if he could get Job through this trial, that he could bless Job on the other end. God was up to something, but Job didn't know any of that. Come on, somebody. And right now in the middle of your life, if you look at your circumstances, you look at your losses, you look at the expectations, you look at the disappointments and discouragements of your life, you don't know what God is up to. Unless it's an unusual case where you had a word from God. And listen, most of the time when you look in the Bible and you see God blessing somebody or God prospering something, most of the time, they don't get everything back they lost overnight. Unless you're Nebuchadnezzar and God was teaching him a lesson. Hello?
Yeah.
Let's take a look at it. Genesis chapter 26, we see Isaac, right? A lot of times we want the blessings like Isaac won. We want prosperity. We want that he began to prosper. He continued to prosper until he became very prosperous. God, I want to be very prosperous. Look at what he had to go through. Genesis 26, verse 12 and 13, then Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same what? Year. A hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. Verse 13, the man began to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous. Did you notice all the time words in there? So it took Isaac a year. It was within a year, but it was still a year. Hello? That he began, continued until he became. See, when you sow a seed, you don't become very prosperous the next day. It takes time for that seed to go into the ground, to die, to germinate, to push through the soil, to come up, to create the plant, till eventually it's the time and the season for fruit, to where it bears the buds, and then all of a sudden it brings forth the fruit, and then you have to reap. Reaping is work, by the way. And then finally, you get to partake of the fruits. But it takes time. One of my favorite quotes from Pastor Jim and Pastor Deborah is this. Is that what we are today is because we outlasted the problems of yesterday. See, I know we all want to prosper. I don't have to ask if you want to be prosperous. I know you want to be prosperous. You want to be blessed. All of us would say, yeah, I could handle more. I would love to be blessed. I would love to have more. I would love to be encouraged. I would love to have that double, but we don't want the trouble. But here's the determining factor. It's time. Prosperity is a process, and God is leading us through what he needs to do in our hearts, leading us through life. And he wants to see us integrous. He wants to see us strong. He wants to see us connected to him, worshiping him. See, if we assumed that each of Job's 10 children that he got at the end of his life were conceived consecutively, let's just say the day after one was born, hey, they conceived right the very next day. It would have taken 7.5 years for them to have all 10 of those children. So did God give him back double for everything? Yeah, he did. But I would imagine that those flocks didn't come overnight. I would imagine that his grain and his land didn't come overnight. I would imagine that his children, he didn't have 10 children all at once, like, you know, one of those television shows on TLC or something like that. There was no super babies or drugs or the Octomoms or any of that kind of stuff. This was the natural process of life. And it probably took around a decade after the trials that Job went through for him to regain everything that happened to him. Yes, he went through loss, and yes, he did prosper in the end, and that was the intent of the Lord at the end of everything, but he still had to persevere. Church, for all of us, we've got to go through the valley of the shadow of death and fear no evil along the way, because God is with us and God is leading us through. What did we learn tonight? A guide to handling loss. Number one, worship God in loss. You may fall to your knees, but make sure you fall to your knees in a position and a posture of praise and worshiping the Lord. Second is this, hold fast to your integrity. Continuously speak the goodness of God. Continuously stay connected with the Lord. Third is speak life to others. There's going to be people around you that come and they don't understand or they're falling apart, and you need to speak life into them. And then finally, persevere. Hold on through the loss. Hold on through the trial. Did you guys get something from the word of the Lord tonight? God is good. God is good. Well, I want to take just a couple more minutes. I want to talk to you guys before you leave this place. It's been a great night. I believe you guys got something from the Lord. And I'm going to just ask you, take a moment. I want you guys to focus in. Don't get up. Don't leave during this time. I want to just take a couple more moments, and then we'll let you go. I want to ask you a question. What if? What if tonight was it? What if it's all over? What if Jesus came back? Or what if this was your last night on the earth? God forbid that should happen to anybody. I'm not speaking that over anybody. But what if tonight was your last night on the earth and you died? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Just answer that question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. Some of you might have answered this way. You might have said, well, I don't believe in hell, therefore I believe I'm going to heaven. Do you know hell's a very real place? Jesus talked about hell. It's in the Old and New Testament. Now you might be thinking, but wait a second, if hell's real, why would God want to send someone to hell? Well, he doesn't. In fact, the Bible says God mourns when people die and go to hell. It doesn't please God. But God loves us so much that he gave us a free will choice while we're here on the earth, whether we're going to love him and serve him or whether we're going to reject him. And if that's our choice, is to reject him, then we've made our choice. But God did open the way for us to be with him and to go to heaven. Now, sometimes people say, well, that's good news because, you know, all roads lead to heaven. Now that Jesus died and gone to the cross, it's ollie oxen free. Everybody can come out and come in. And I believe that we're going to go to heaven because all roads lead to heaven. You do your thing, I'll do my thing. The churches out there can do whatever they want to do. We'll all make it to whatever we call heaven somehow, some way. But you know, that's not what the Bible says. Nowhere in the Bible say all roads lead to heaven. That's like me sitting here on the earth saying all roads lead to the moon. You'd say you're crazy. You can drive around the earth as long as you want. You'll never make it. In fact, you won't even make it to every part of the earth. You'll be confined to the land. In the same way, what makes us think that we can do whatever we want to do and somehow, pop, beat me up, Scotty, now I'm in heaven because I just did whatever I want to do? It doesn't work like that. In fact, the Bible says that the road to heaven is narrow and there are few who find it. But the way to destruction is wide and open. Many are on it. Tonight, I want to show you that road. Let me shed some light. Don't let anything distract you right now. I want to show you that way. Jesus made this statement. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. See, it's God's heaven. We've got to get there God's way. Now, sometimes people think, well, that's good news, Pastor, because, you know, I've been a really good person. I've done a lot of good in my lifetime. Helped out people, gave money to charities, been involved in social justice causes. I've been a really good person. I believe that I'm going to go to heaven, you know, because I've been good. I think I've done enough good. I used to be bad, clean up my act. Now my good really outweighs my bad. I think I'm going to make it because I'm good. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible says you can be good enough? In fact, the Bible says if you're trying to get to heaven based on your goodness, the standard is perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. And the Bible records that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to make it to heaven just by being good. And yet a lot of people think that they can just be good and they're going to make it. I love you enough tonight to tell you the truth. Not going to make it. Some of you might have said, well, you know, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. In fact, we're born in America. America's a Christian nation. We're not any other religions. Therefore, we're Christians. Maybe they hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. You went to religious classes like Sunday school or Sabbath school, maybe catechism class. You've always thought of yourself to be a Christian, and therefore you think that you're going to heaven because you were raised in church. But you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you just be raised in church, parents tell you you're a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Nowhere in the Bible does it say be born in America because you're not some other religion that by default God lumps you into the category of being a Christian headed for heaven. Nowhere in the Bible does it say you attend religious classes, wear religious jewelry, or be baptized or christened as a child, and you get to go to heaven. Come on, let's talk about your life. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, well, I'm going to heaven, not only because of when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church in front of you right now, and I consider myself to be a Christian. But did you know that you can't just sit in church and call yourself a Christian? That makes you a Christian. It's like me saying, you know what? I really want to be an automobile. And I go to my house, and I sit in the garage, and I call myself a car and think that that's going to make me a car. It doesn't matter if I put on a t-shirt that says Ford or Honda or whatever, make car noises. Doesn't matter if I get on all fours and drive around the car lot and park myself in the garage. Listen, I am not a car. So what makes us think that we can just walk into a church, sit in a seat in a sanctuary, warm up a spot, say I'm a Christian, and that makes us a Christian? Don't we love to label ourselves in this country? And yet, just because you call yourself something doesn't make you that thing. Can't just call yourself a Christian, sit in church service, that makes you a Christian. Sometimes people say, but pastor, hold on a second, you don't understand. My last church, I got involved. I helped out, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I even taught in the Bible classes, got a membership card to that church. And while that's great, and I'm glad you did those things, could you just show that to me in the Bible where you help out? Sing in the choir, make decisions, people think of you as a leader. Carry the pastor's Bible, or because you teach in the Bible classes, you get to go to heaven. It's not there. Nowhere in the Bible does it say God is looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. It doesn't work like that. Come on, let's talk about your life. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, pastor, I got you on this one. Someone told me that if I know God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I know about Jesus, celebrate Easter and the resurrection, sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, pastor. Doesn't that mean I'm a Christian? Well, if that was the qualifications, then wouldn't the demons be headed for heaven because they know who Jesus is, believe he's the Son of God? They're not Christians. The devil himself can quote scriptures out of his mouth and knows who Jesus is, and yet we know he's not going to heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. Having some mental ascent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, being able to celebrate a holiday, sing a song or quote a scripture, but rather this is about your heart. God's always been after your heart. Jesus said it like this to a religious leader of his day. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know. Probably some of you guys turned off right now. You said, ugh, born again. Man, that just leaves a bad taste in my mouth. Saw that in a movie. You know, read about that on a blog on the internet. You know, they had some people in the newspaper that said they were born again and they were weird. I just don't want to have any part of that. If I had known that's what you were talking about, we would have gone to another church tonight. But listen, God is speaking to you right now. And I don't want you to let the world define for you what being born again is. Shouldn't we find out from the Bible what being born again means? Absolutely. Listen, it's always meant the same thing from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. What does being born again really mean? Well, it means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. Just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Pretty gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. What's he saying, lukewarm? What's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight, I'm going to give you an opportunity. It's going to look like this. I'm going to count to three. One, two, three, and then pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. Then you can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second, time out. You're going to point and count? If you do that, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be embarrassed. Let's get over that, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Yet, insecurity is going to try and hold you back. The devil's going to try and talk you out of this. Listen, push past the flesh, tell the devil, go jump in a fiery lake. Let's go on with God tonight. In fact, Jesus said this. He said, if you confess me before man, well, man, I'll see your hand go up. He says, I'll confess you before my Father who's in heaven. How cool is that? But he says, if you deny me, sit there and do nothing when you know you need to be right. You made your choice. He says, I will deny you. Your call, your choice. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on. You can get your hand up and then come into the church service or tell an usher right afterwards. If you're watching online, wherever you're at, God sees and God's watching right now. You can lift your hand and then you can minimize your video browser, click the blue button that says respond to God, or go to our homepage, How to Know God. Find the tab, click on that, and someone will lead you in a prayer. Tonight, come on, this is your night of salvation. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. If you're not sure about your salvation, tonight is your night. Make sure. If you've never done this, never given God all of your heart and all of your life, come on, I'm speaking to you. Or if you're lukewarm, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get right with God. Here we go. All together, if you need to do this, get ready. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. If that's you need to give God all of your heart, need to give God all of your life. Thank you. There's one, two, three. Got you guys over there. Three wise people already. Who else? Who else tonight? There's three wise people already. There's four. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else tonight? Four wise people. Five got you over there. Thank you. Thank you. You can put your hand down over there. Five wise people already. Anybody else? Six got you. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? Come on, just get your hand up high for me. If I'm looking in your direction, you can just wave it at me. Anybody else real quick? Real quick. I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Six, seven. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? You're saying, I want to be included in this. I want to make sure I'm going to heaven. Tonight is your night. Anybody else real quick? Come on, just raise it up high for me. About six or seven wise people. That's you. Just raise it up high. Anybody else? Last call. I'm going to wrap this thing up. Come on, don't miss this opportunity if you need to do this. You've missed enough opportunities in your life. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a hand for about six or seven wise people. Yeah. We're so excited for you guys. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, here's what I want you to do. It's not too late. Why don't you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Why don't you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down there. If you're sitting next to somebody, raise their hand, make a way for them to come out, encourage them to come. Maybe give them a little nudge. Nudge your neighbor and say, come on, friend. If you need to go, I'll go with you tonight. So let's all stand and welcome them. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, get your stuff, get a friend if you need a friend, get in the aisle. Meet me up front right now. Come on down. Come on down. Jesus, come on. They're coming. Let's give them a hand. You can come too. Anybody else, if you need to come, you just come to the front right now. Come on down. Come on, come on, come on. All right, if you still need to come while I'm giving some instructions, you're welcome to make your way to the front. Hey, everybody up front, look up here. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, okay? All right, came to give God all your heart, came to give God all of your life. Going to be born again. Today's a brand new day. First day of the rest of your life. It's awesome, all right? Now, right over here, look this direction. See this guy waving at you? This is Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. Nothing weird's going on, all right? You already got past my interpretation of Job's wife. He's cool, okay? He's going to do three things. Number one thing he's going to do, he's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. Secondly, I'm going to give you some free information, some free literature to read about what to do next in your walk with God. It's easy reading, okay? If you read slow, it might take about 20 minutes, half an hour, something like that. But it'll just help you to find out, now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next? Okay? And then finally, he'll give you what we call a spiritual personal trainer. Okay? Let me describe it to you like this. It's a friend in church. Okay? So take a big, deep breath. It's okay. All right? Just a friend. Someone who will come alongside you, encourage you, and teach you some things from the Bible, like we talked about tonight. Okay? Things that will get you strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back to your old ways, right? Or go back to the devil, but then you go on with God for the rest of your days. All right? He'll describe how that works. It's easy. It's free. You need to do it. Okay? All right? Super simple. And then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. If you guys just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.